Kuati hopa gaita with the diask, dushne me kaispich, say to Jamihano, tes e kaschak, shutuna washti, ishkawa akume etamaya meshita. Good morning, everyone. I hope everyone is in good health and well today. My name is Tanea Garcia, and I am a sophomore from the Acoma in Santa Ana Pueblo in New Mexico. I am standing before you today to acknowledge and pay respect to the original owners of this land that Lawrence University sits on, the Menominee Nation, or the Mama Cheta, is what they call themselves. Without further ado, I hereby acknowledge the land that Lawrence University sits on. Lawrence University's Appleton and Door County campuses are located on the ancestral homelands of the Menominee Nation. Currently, there are 11 federally recognized Native American sovereign nations in Wisconsin. We acknowledge these indigenous communities who have stewarded this land through the generations and pay respect to the elders past and present. Tawa'e, thank you.
Thanks to Philip Swan, Stephen Seek, and the Welcome Week Choir, and thank you to Tanea Garcia for reading our land acknowledgement this morning. You did a great job. Good morning. My name is Beth Sinsley, and as chair of the Public Events Committee, it is my pleasure to announce this year's Convocation series. But first, if something seems different about Convo today, it's not just that Bruce Bengston was at the organ instead of Kathy Hanford. You probably also noticed that there are no paper programs. In an effort to reduce waste for today's event, the program can be found at go.lawrence.edu/convo. That's go.lawrence.edu/convo. This year's Convocation series features Russian-American journalist, author, and activist Masha Gessen. On January 16th, she will join us for a talk on the parallel polis. Gessen's writings on the current leaders of Russia and the United States, autocracy, LGBT rights, and the punk band Pussy Riot have functioned as both political critique and call to action. Drawn from work on a forthcoming book, Gessen's convocation address will focus on the sociopolitical concept of the parallel polis, an idea conceived of by Czech intellectual Václav Benda and embraced by Czech dissident and President Václav Havel. The parallel polis is an alternative social structure through which citizens can advocate for and protect their rights in defiance of an unresponsive government. For the Honors Convocation on May 28th, our colleague Amy Ongiri, the Jill Beck Director of Film Studies and Associate Professor of Film Studies, will speak on the importance of failure. Following work in cognitive studies and queer theory, Professor Ongiri will explore the idea of failure beyond its relationship to future success. For example, does failure itself have inherent value? Can failure ultimately be its own reward? I look forward to thinking about the importance of failure on a day when we also celebrate student achievements and successes, and I hope you will join me. Our series begins, of course, with today's matriculation convocation by President Mark Burstein. Though Mark's address will focus on the future, I want to take a moment here to think about the past, specifically the history of the Convocation series at Lawrence University. Gatherings of the whole campus community began shortly after the college was founded in the form of twice daily chapel services. The term convocation first appeared in the Lawrence catalog for the 1926-27 academic year. The frequency of convocations varied, and student attendance was required at convocations until 1968, when the faculty voted to reduce the number to just 2 meetings per year, the matriculation and honors convos, and to drop the student attendance requirement. The 11:10 time slot on Tuesdays and Thursdays was set in 1979, also by faculty vote. While in some ways that answers how we find ourselves sitting together in the Memorial Chapel on a Thursday morning, there is still the larger question of why the convocation tradition has persisted at Lawrence. During President Nathan Pusey's tenure, the catalog described convocations as, quote, a kind of general all-college course without formal requirements or credit. I think that fits, but to me it's actually much more than that. Convocations represent a larger and enduring commitment to intellectual inquiry and open discourse among our community spurred on by the speakers we bring to this stage. I encourage all of you to join me in preserving this commitment by attending our convocation series this year. Now, please join me in welcoming President Mark Burstein for his matriculation address, "Is Our Future Too Hot to Handle?"
Beth, thank you for your continued leadership of the Public Events Committee. Beth is serving her second year as chair, so let's give her a round of applause for that. I want to welcome Bruce Bengston. Thank you for that beautiful organ prelude. Thank you, Stephen Seek, Philip Swan, and members of the entering class for beginning our year with such beauty. I look forward to many future performances. Thank you, Tanea Garcia, class of 22, for reading our land acknowledgement this morning. And thank you, Linda Morgan Clement, for providing closing words for today's convocation. I also want to thank the many members of the Lawrence community who helped me research this talk today. I am grateful to the Public Events Committee for assembling a provocative and engaging convocation series for us to enjoy, as Beth relayed. This year, in response to the Emotional Well-Being Task Force's view that our academic calendar is over-programmed, we have limited this series of convocations to three, one each term. We expect this year to work as a community to find other ways to balance the intellectual, social, and personal elements of a Lawrence experience and discover ways to add more reflection time into our lives. Welcome to the academic year. I want to specifically welcome over 400 first-year transfer and visiting students, five new tenure-line faculty, and many other new faculty and staff. I know you will join me in extending a warm Lawrence welcome to all members of our community. I start here about weather, and I think it's very fitting that it's raining just like it is on commencement. So we had rain for commencement and rain for matriculation convocation, a bookend for the summer. And our weather is starting to cool down right now, but fire has been on my mind and in the news this summer. Over the past 2 months, the world has become aware of the significant increase in fires that threaten the Amazon. The Brazilian National Institute for Space Research, as of August 23rd, tracked close to 73,000 fires in that country since the beginning of the year. More than half occurred in the Amazon. The equivalent of 1.5 soccer fields of rainforest have been consumed every minute of every day this year, an increase of 80% from last year. Many tie these events to both the pressure for additional grazing land for cattle, which provides critical livelihood for local inhabitants, and the now implicit support of this land usage by a new federal government in Brazil. According to the World Wildlife Fund, the Amazon spans 8 countries and covers 40% of South America, an area that is nearly two-thirds as large as the United States. This forest absorbs carbon dioxide through photosynthesis and produces about 20% of the Earth's oxygen. Many refer to the Amazon as the planet's lungs. An overwhelming majority of scientists believe the Amazon fires will have a devastating impact on the Earth's ability to produce oxygen and to generate rain, including the precipitation essential for farms here in the Midwest. These fires also impact biodiversity. The Amazon is home to large numbers of mammals, birds, amphibians, reptiles, most of them unique to the region. A new plant or animal species is discovered there every 2 days. Other parts of the world are also burning. Hotter, drier weather has created fire conditions from Alaska and the Arctic to the Canary Islands and California. According to the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, the global temperature for the month of July was the highest since recording began in 1880. In addition to the environmental impact of these fires, the spectacular pictures brought to mind the scholarship of Lawrence Professor of History and Latin American Studies, Jake Frederick. He teaches us that fire through history has represented domestication, conflict, and consumption. But these fires, which consume many parts of the world, fall into a different category, he suggests, fire as foe. July in Appleton was hotter than usual, but we felt the impact of the climate crisis more directly this past winter when a polar vortex descended in late January. It brought temperatures lower than 40 below, which established new records throughout Wisconsin and the Midwest. The governor declared a state of emergency. Schools were closed, and basic services like the U.S. Postal Service ceased. Some of us, expecting the planet to be warming, not cooling, did not immediately connect our Arctic weather with the climate crisis. But some climatologists now believe that warming air in the Arctic forced colder conditions south into the upper Midwest. The inconveniences we experienced last winter, missed classes and practices, frozen pipes and ears, paled in comparison to the challenges that face people in other places. The citizens of island countries in the Pacific, for example, directly confront the problem of rising oceans because their island homes crest only 3 to 4 feet above sea level. As the ocean rises, some countries have begun to try to raise land levels or to plan for total and permanent evacuation of their island homes. Weather-related events have displaced an average of 24 million people every year since 2008. The World Bank estimates that another 143 million people will be displaced by 2050 in just three regions: sub-Saharan Africa, South Asia, and Latin America. According to estimates from Swiss Re, an insurance company, natural disasters caused $165 billion of economic losses worldwide in 2018. These losses and displacements illustrate the impact of a global climate crisis. Increased frequency of destructive storms, rising water levels due to melting ice caps, and changing weather patterns now affect millions of people every year. 20 years ago, I worked in West Harlem with Peggy Shepherd, executive director of We Act for Environmental Justice, and recipient of a Lawrence honorary degree in 2018. She taught me that the impact of the climate crisis hits low-income populations the hardest. According to a study by the World Bank, 100 million people could be forced into extreme poverty by the end of 2020 as their home environments deteriorate due to climate-induced changes in weather patterns. As an institution that prepares students to be citizens of this nation and others around the world, we have developed many initiatives that offer insight into central global challenge. Our environmental studies program provides excellent opportunities to learn about environmental systems from economic, policy, cultural, biological, chemical, and geoscience perspectives. Thanks to a grant from the Margaret A. Cargill Foundation and leadership by both Special Assistant to the President Jeff Clark and our Sustainability Coordinator Kelsey McCormick, we are turning the Appleton and Door County campuses into living laboratories. Within these communities, we have the opportunity to learn about the choices we make through daily habits that affect the environment. They also lead the university's efforts to conserve resources and lessen our environmental impact on our surrounding communities. We have hosted numerous speakers who work on this central issue, including our own David Gerard, the John R. Kimberly Distinguished Professor in American Economic Systems, who gave a convocation in 2015 that helped us understand the economics of climate change. But our efforts and those of colleges across the country to clarify the most important challenge the human race will face over the next decade are easier said than done. Researchers help us understand the forces that work against our best efforts. Riley Dunlap and Aaron McWright, among others, have shown that political and economic forces have worked to discredit climate science. In an article entitled "The Politicization of Climate Change and the Polarization in the American Public's View of Global Warming," they detail the effect of these forces on our awareness of this problem. Using the Gallup Organization's annual environmental poll for a 10-year period, Dunlap and McWright also clarified the impact of both political belief and college education on people's views on climate change. Dunlap and McWright found that 82% of college graduates who identified as liberals or Democrats believed that climate change existed and that human activity is a contributing factor to climate change. 62% of liberals or Democrats without a college degree had the same view. Among those with a college degree who identify as conservative or Republican, 43% believe that climate change existed. 42% of conservatives or Republicans without a college degree had the same view. There are at least two remarkable aspects of this data. First, political beliefs significantly influence one's views of the climate crisis. Second, and maybe even more important for us, a college education has little impact on students' understanding of climate science if they identify as conservative or Republican. I'm concerned that the Lawrence community may follow both of these patterns in which political belief supersedes scientific facts. But even those who agree that a climate crisis is real, approach the issue now with incapacitating fatigue. In Falter, Has the Human Game Begun to Play Itself Out? Bill McKibben stated, climate change has become such a familiar term that we tend to read past it. It's part of our mental furniture, like urban sprawl or gun violence. To correct this attitude, the American Meteorological Society now suggests using the phrase climate crisis. Even though extreme weather has become commonplace, they ask that descriptions include the unusual nature of events. For example, there are many locations in the United States that now repeatedly experience what was once considered a flood that should happen only every 500 years. They ask meteorologists to describe such events so that all of us will understand what should be extraordinary has now become ordinary. But no amount of improved communication seems to weaken the feeling that this crisis is inevitable, that nothing we can do will change the course of this unfolding natural disaster. This attitude prevents important interventions. Dunlap and McWright finished their study in 2011, But the division between those who do and those who do not accept the urgency of the climate crisis has persisted. A survey completed by the Yale Program on Climate Change Communications in 2018 continued to find stark differences in people's views according to their political affiliation. They found that 52% of Republicans and 91% of Democrats believe that global warming is happening. It appears that our deeply divided social environment continues to extend to views on the climate crisis. In a recent Wall Street Journal opinion piece, Jim Mattis, President Trump's first Secretary of Defense, described our situation this way. We are dividing into hostile tribes, cheering against each other, fueled by emotion and mutual disdain that jeopardizes our future, instead of rediscovering our common ground and finding solutions. This adversarial approach that ignores the need for policy to protect our environment is a relatively new phenomenon. For generations, leaders of the United States held a more common view of environmental issues. When asked who the greenest presidents of the United States was, leaders of 12 national environmental organizations, such as Greenpeace, the Nature Conservancy, and the Sierra Club, chose Teddy Roosevelt, Richard Nixon, Jimmy Carter, and Barack Obama as the top four presidents in that order. Two Republicans and two Democrats. Conservation was central to Teddy Roosevelt's vision for America's future. He preserved land and natural beauty at the Grand Canyon, Yosemite, and hundreds of other locations across the country. Richard Nixon founded the Environmental Protection Agency, banned DDT, and created the regulatory infrastructure that continues to this day. But this public consensus is disappearing. The lack of consensus brought Frank Bruni to suggest in an opinion piece in the New York Times that dogs will fix our broken democracy. His recent experience as a dog owner made him realize that dogs provide the impetus to interact outside of one's prescribed group. People are no longer conservatives or progressives. Instead, they are Bandit's owner or Pet Sitting Daisy. As a new dog owner myself, I agree with Frank Bruni that owning a dog widens your social circles immensely, and scooping up poop is a great social leveler. But I do not believe that requiring every Laurentian to own a dog is the right solution for our community. So if dog ownership will not energize every Laurentian to engage more deeply with the climate crisis, then what should we do to more fully embrace our central role in fostering an educated citizenry? We need to continue to believe in the power of the role we play. As one of our founding fathers, James Madison, said, "Knowledge will forever govern ignorance, and a people who mean to be their own governors must arm themselves with the power which knowledge gives." I believe we must first acknowledge the challenge to reach all members of our community. Will Happer's year-long term as science advisor to President Trump brought home to me the importance of acknowledging this challenge. Will was a colleague during my time at Princeton, a well-regarded physicist whose research focuses on optics. Will rejects the scientific consensus on climate change. During my time at Princeton, I spoke with climate scientists there, some of them international leaders in their fields, about how to engage Will on this topic. Their response was, "He's a physicist, not a climate scientist. No one will take him seriously." Well, he set our country's carbon policy for the last year. It is crucial that we engage with those who dismiss the findings of 97% of climate scientists who now confirm that a climate crisis has begun and that human activity is a root cause. We need to continue to broaden the learning opportunities we offer and to avoid partisan framing of the climate crisis if we aim to reach all of our students, faculty, and staff. Thanks to the interdisciplinary nature of environmental studies program, we offer a wide array of learning opportunities for students to consider how human activity impacts the natural world. But I think that other avenues of exploration are also available to us. Direct and sustained experience of the natural world can open our minds to how human activity impacts the environment. Experiences can sensitize us to the deep and far-reaching effect that the climate crisis will have. My year as a farmer during a break between high school and college changed my views and established conservation as central to my personal values. Living directly in the cycle of a dairy farm significantly influenced the way I thought about the natural world. I am sure each of you have your own connection to nature. Could we find additional ways to encourage all of us to explore the rich natural resources of northeastern Wisconsin and Door County? Could this be a way to reach students who might otherwise avoid enrolling in an environmental studies course or joining an environmental organization? Are there ways we can more closely tie the prodigious natural world that surrounds us into our curriculum? Science continues to be a central avenue to help us understand the climate crisis and to recognize the ways our own human activity impacts the natural world. According to our general education requirements, we believe that every student should learn to use their understanding of a scientific concept to interpret a natural phenomena and to draw reasonable conclusions from scientific data. I applaud colleagues working to redesign our introductory science courses with the support of a grant from the Howard Hughes Medical Institute. As we rethink pedagogy, sequence, and content, could we also rethink this core graduate requirement to ensure that all of our students will graduate understanding basic scientific facts? Aside from curricular requirements, could we provide more ways to engage with science on our campus? Rachel Carson's Silent Spring helped an entire generation understand the harmful impacts of pesticides by giving the lay reader access to the science involved. I was very pleased to see the death and life of the Great Lakes selected as a community read last year, and to have its author, Dan Egan, join us on campus for a talk. As a non-scientist, he allows the reader to understand how human activity is killing the world's largest freshwater system. Timefulness, How Thinking Like a Geologist Can Help Save the World, written by our own Marcia Bjornrud, the Walter Schober Professor of Environmental Studies, offers a different and important frame within which we can consider the climate crisis. Can we find new paths to access the way scientific knowledge unlocks our understanding of the world's present and future? For many humanists, like me, other avenues to comprehend the climate crisis also are important. The relationship between humans and the natural world has fostered essential values for many cultures and religions. Native American, Hinduism, Christianity, Judaism, and many other traditions provide clear direction. For example, when Pope Francis declared a climate emergency this past spring, he said, "Future generations stand to inherit a greatly spoiled world. Our children and grandchildren should not have to pay the cost of our generation's irresponsibility."
Pope Francis echoes many Native American traditions. For example, the Iroquois have a saying, "In our every deliberation, we must consider the impact of our decisions on the next seven generations." Hinduism teaches that all living things, human, animal, vegetable, are sacred because they are part of God. They must be shown respect. Can we provide more access to these and other teachings that encourage us to consider the place and responsibility of human beings within the natural world? Maybe most difficult for those of us who believe the climate crisis is the central challenge facing society today is to approach this crisis and with the consideration for the skeptics, the members of our community who do not accept climate science. One of the tasks I had when I joined the New York City Department of Sanitation in the 1990s was to write the city's commercial recycling laws with colleagues. The team comprised members who represented business interests and others who held fervent environmental beliefs. Some argued all garbage must be recycled. Others believed mandatory recycling would place an undue burden on commercial establishments, especially ones that were family owned. I asked all committee members to tone down the accusatory rhetoric and to consider options that would work for all parties. In the end, we agreed to mandating recycling only of material whose beneficial reuse ensured that recycling would be less expensive than disposal. It was hard for me to modify my passionate commitment to this project. But to get all on board, I needed to moderate the conversation so all could participate and find the middle ground. For us now to engage our entire community, we must provide a learning environment in which we can all participate without criticism or rejection. I am sure that within this community, there are many other ideas that would help us to deepen our learning of the ways human activity impacts the environment. I hope you will commit yourselves with me to making sure that this generation of Laurentians will graduate with the knowledge, the tools, and the energy to provide leadership on the most important challenge that faces all of us in this century. I look forward to hearing your reactions, disagreements, and responses to my words today. Good luck in this new academic year. Thank you for creating this learning community we call Lawrence. It is a pleasure, an absolute pleasure, to have you all back here in Appleton. Thank you.
Laurentians, President Burstein has challenged us to lean into the complicated challenge of our time, climate change, climate crisis. As a community of learners and activists, teachers and thinkers, we are capable of imagining a new way that can reshape our worldviews and our values to make possible a shared future for our world. We will do this from diverse perspectives, with differing skills and temperaments, with influence on communities across the globe, and each experiencing our joy, our fear, and our hope in a rainbow of hues. But we must engage this commitment together, valuing the strength of our differing approaches, leaning in across our disagreements and divisions, listening and and speaking, with humility and human emotion and intellect, as we try to learn what it really means to love the earth, the water, and the children, with hearts big enough to change. I close us with a poem by Daniel Berrigan, activist, Catholic man of faith, courageous felon, who speaks to me about what is required and what it will take. Some, a poem by Dan Berrigan. Some stood up once and sat down. Some walked a mile and walked away. Some stood up twice, then sat down. It's too much, they cried. Some walked 2 miles, then walked away. I've had it, they cried. Some stood and stood and stood. They were taken for fools, they were taken for being taken in. And some walked and walked and walked. They walked the earth, they walked the waters, they walked the air. Why do you stand, they were asked, and why do you walk? Because of the children, they said, and because of the heart, because of the bread, because this is the heart's beat, the children born and risen bread.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.